I'm Ron Reinhardt. I sing. I'm obnoxious. And I'm rude.
And I'm focusing guts. Okay, do something sick.
That's sick.
Okay.
And I'm Mike. I'm a bass player. My name is Oz. Everybody calls me Gons. And I just like tend to hang out with the band a lot, but it's fun.
I have to talk a little bit louder. I can just barely hear you in this earphone.
Okay.
Here, put a sign. Leave me the fuck alone during the interview.
Really, huh?
I remember your original. Remember you an original?
No, Gons was in before me.
Ron here is our new singer.
I thought you said your name was Gene.
No.
Gene Oakland, you can't miss Gene. Gene is a rather
Gene's like three and a quarter and 6 foot something, big, huge, tall, and he was a beard and mustache.
Pound for pound, he's the heaviest drummer in thrash metal.
He is. He's the heaviest.
Probably all metal.
Yeah, I'm the newest one. I've been in a band for about a year and a half now. The new album, Leave Scars, and our next album, which we haven't decided on the title yet, but should be finished about February 18th.
Yeah. Have you stayed together since we have arrived? Like, have you been on? Like, were you always?
What do you mean, us as band members?
Yeah. I mean, like, the band. Or did the band ever break up?
No, the band's never split up. It's gone through numerous personnel changes. I mean, a lot of people, they just can't deal with touring. I mean, they want to have a regular life. You know, they don't want to be on the road. They want to be home with their families and their wives, so to speak, of certain people. And it just gets kind of hectic.
I miss the back of my hand. This the plug probably looks like the back. Come on, Don. Shithead. Damn, take it. Sounds like me and my brothers. Shithead. Yeah, prick. Yeah. Can't scream. Yeah. Okay, fuck is all. Oh, wait. I gotta get close up with the chick.
This is shit.
There's one deal. Reinhardt, I'm the newest member of Dark Angel. I've been bound for about a year and a half. I sing, I'm rude, I'm obnoxious, and I stage dive.
We wouldn't want him any other way. I'm Mike Gonzalez. I'm a bass player. Everybody calls me Gons. I generally hang out, play bass for the band, and
drink.
Raise hell.
And turn up missing with rude, obnoxious people.
Yeah.
But that won't be mentioned.
Yeah. We're here to give our tour manager headaches, basically. That's about it.
And to rage for the people that support us and come see us. Any questions?
Yeah, we got some questions. See, I don't want to do a video interview as well, because...
Oh, don't be shy.
Let me see.
If you don't want to work with the camera, that's all.
I already asked you about the original members.
Yeah.
And you're new.
Yeah, as I was saying, the band's...
Was it hard to adapt? Have you been in other bands before?
Everyone in this band has played in another band or at a different band at one time or another. Like, we've all gone through the thing where playing in copy bands, top 40 bands, playing on the local club circuit in LA.
But you never played with any other reputable bands?
No. Just like, you know, we all started out young, wanting to break into music. It's a hard business. Nobody really cares, you know, about you in music unless you can do something to prove yourself. So when we got it, you know, but I think right now this is like the strongest Dark Angel's ever been.
Yes, definitely.
You know, we went through a lot of headaches, a lot of problems and stuff, but right now it seemed to be working for the best.
How's your record label treating you?
Very good.
We had problems with them on our last album, Darkness Descends. We weren't quite happy with the promotion that it received or anything. And what happened was we started shopping around a little bit, looking at other labels and such. And it turned out we had a couple of offers from majors, and Combat started to realize, hey, you know, we're going to lose these guys. And I guess they feel that we're a pretty valuable commodity to them. And they renegotiated our contract for us, which they pretty much equaled anything anyone else was going to offer us.
Yeah,
and now they're just being god to us.
Yeah, we got the same deal as a major label, you know, because a lot of major labels gave us a lot of bids, and Combat kept us, and they, like, did everything in their power. They're, you know, really treating us well and help us out and, like, sticking behind us, so... You know, plus we get along with, you know, a lot of people from the label. They're not like suit and tie, stuffed shirt, executive jerks, you know. They're like, you know, like you and me and him and them.
All these kids out here.
Yeah, you know, they drink. They're into the scene, you know. They're into the speed metal, thrash scene, whatever the hell you want to call it. So
that's pretty cool.
So they're not like they're just businessmen.
No,
there's a couple of people here you would not be able to tell them apart from any one of these kids in the crowd.
You
I mean, just because of the way they look. You can't judge them by the way they look. They're not some mutant off the street. And I'm not calling anybody like that. Any of our friends that come to see us, I'm not calling them that either. But they have all really good business sense, but they tend to fit in with everybody also.
They wear like Levi's, t-shirts, jeans. They don't...
Yeah, basically they're just not intimidating when you're trying to work with them, you know. You feel like you're on a one-to-one level.
How are they with album covers, like censorship?
With this album right here, they were really worried about like PMRC because they wanted to put the lyrics in the album. And some of our lyrics are pretty graphic, you know, topics like pedophilia, which is child molestation, things like that. And they were getting really weird about it because they figured a lot of these major chains wouldn't carry it along with us. A lot of this, I guess I should say PMRC, is causing a lot of hassles with that. But finally we worked it all out, and they did print the lyrics, and so far we haven't had any problems with it at all.
Well, your lyrics... I've never seen your lyric sheet before. Is it like just, are they profane?
There's no cuss words in the songs. It's just, child molestation is a very real topic, and people think if they turn their heads, it will disappear. So if you bring something like that out into the open, a lot of people are uncomfortable discussing child molestation, which it overpowers rape and missing children all the time, you know? So we bring something like that out, and it's not hell, praise Satan, you know, because that's just... A lot of people write that off as myth, which is very real. But you write about child molestation, you upset a lot of people, and it offends a lot of people. But it's out there, and you know, they don't like to deal with it. That's
Gene wrote the song, the main song we're talking about. It's called "The Death of Innocence." It's written from within the first person, the child molester himself, and he's saying that he knows what he's doing. He knows it's a sick act. He wants to be caught. He wants to get the
word. He wants to be killed.
Yeah, he wants to be healed, I should say.
Yeah, you know, in the lyrics it says, "Somebody please stop or kill me."
And a lot of people tend to take that wrong. I mean, even with a lot of our song titles, they tend to have a morbid side to the title itself, but they don't realize. I mean, like, say, for example, a song like "Death is Certain, Life is Not." A lot of kids think that it's like going on about killing posers or something like that, which is entirely not true. It's more about a real life situation, again with Gene, about how his uncle was on a life support system, and, you know, they were trying to decide whether to pull the plug or not, which is a really hard topic to deal with, unless it's euthanasia.
Especially about someone you care about. You know, a lot of people say, well, write a song about trauma, and there's a difference to say, well, child molestation's bad, and, you know, you shouldn't rape and beat up little children. But that's like beating around the bush, to crawl inside of somebody, and to get the inside on them, you know, and to, like, you know, try to see their views. It is a very sick act, you know, and, you know, a lot of people... just they don't like to deal with that reality in it. You know, they think that to go that far into something makes you one, but no, it makes us trying to bring up a very sick point that happens to our children. It's every day. It's a part of everyday life. There's like, they can't even report how many cases that they know about, you know, the case that they don't know about, children who just live being tortured like that. But other than that, we're not devil worshippers or anything. We're just loud, rude, obnoxious.
Fun going.
Yeah, we like to have fun, and we like to see all of our friends come out here and dive and slam and thrash. I'd rather have my kid at a gig than out, you know, using heavy drugs and being a loser and, you know, sleeping on the street. You know, these kids come out here and they thrash and stage dive and they sleep good at night. And, you know, when I thrash and stage dive all night, I sleep good too, when the tour allows it.
Yeah.
I don't know, how's the tour going so far?
Ooh, well, where do you want to begin? We've gone through a lot of major fiascos on this trip. Pittsburgh
We got picketed by Christians for saying we're devil worshippers, and we had the news media out there saying we're devil worshippers, which is a crock of shit. And then where'd it go from there?
Let's see, we went from Pittsburgh, we went into Buffalo, and our couple of our backline techs, you know, they met a few girls, and they partied with them all night long. They set them in the RV, and we got up the next morning with a hotel surrounded by police cars, detectives and everything. The girls that they were with, her boyfriend called and said that we kidnapped her. He claimed to be her brother, called, said we kidnapped her. They tried to get us on statutory rape, child molestation, child endangerment, and nothing had ever happened. I mean, the girl was out here just helping us.
Who put the centerfold up there?
Steve, please, we're doing a video.
Oh, man.
You should lock the door.
Come on in, Eric.
Yeah, I'm locked the door. Anyways, so we went through all this big hassle without. They finally let us go. They realized that nothing had happened. The girl was just helping us clean out our trashy RV here. And then, driving down from Canada, working our way down to Trenton, New Jersey, we got into a kind of a slight traffic accident when our equipment truck rear-ended our RV and just wasted the equipment truck, and one of the roadies who happened to be in the back at the time, he was pummeled by equipment. So we've had to send him home now because he's not too healthy at the moment. And then now we also have...
This isn't yours?
This is not ours.
Does a record company let you?
No, it comes out of our tour support. You know, they help support us to get us initially out on the road.
And then
once we start
umbrella.
Playing our shows, we, you know, the money that we make helps keep us going on the road. You know, we went and rented this, and when we take it back, we were in trouble.
No, because a lot of the damage, like when we got an accident, like when the mirrors broke, like some furniture broke.
Yeah, TV
and
fluid.
It needs shampooed and stuff, but don't film all that part. It's hard getting out of one gig. And like the next day, you got to be in an in-store and then go to sound check and then do a gig. So it's like sometimes you get like 6 hours sleep in like 3 days, and you're like, thank God you got that much.
Yeah. Just not enough time to clean the thing up.
Yeah, so it's like lately we've just been
really stressful.
All of you stay in here?
No. We just use this to get to point A to point B, basically.
We usually stay in motels and motels.
Yeah, when we have enough time.
Last, this is just like better than a car or a limo.
Yeah, like the last three gigs, it was kind of like a non-stop kind of thing. We had to go from, you know, one gig to the next gig, and we kind of had to like sleep while we're driving kind of thing. Yeah. But most of the time it's not like that.
You should introduce yourself.
Oh, I'm Eric, by the way. Play guitar.
Eric what?
Meyer. Play guitar.
And what else do you do?
Play with umbrellas.
Umbrella action.
Puzzled him. Sorry, Eric.
How'd you guys do with the ultimate revenge?
Very terrible.
No, that's not true. What happened, it was a blast doing the show. It was a blast doing the show. The kids were crazy. We had a really good time filming it and everything. The only thing was, the band, supposedly, if you want to call them headliners, Raven, took a very long sound check and blew it for everybody else. They spent like 4 hours doing it. We got up there on stage, we got to plug in these amps. All our gear was completely rented. We were not familiar with it at all. We got up there, we plugged into these amps, got it to home, came back later on and did the show.
Yeah, because we
worked with a very unfamiliar ceremony, no monitors and everything. We just did the best we could.
Yeah, we tried to hurry so death and like the rest forbidden and shit.
Yeah, because we're the next sound up right after Raven.
Yeah, you know, so it's like we were up there for like 15 minutes. We tried to hurry. We just got basic tones and did like half a song, and we were out of there.
Also, we went ahead and did the best we could. There's a few little fluffs and mistakes in there, but I mean, that happens at every live show. That gives it a more real live effect, you know? We made mistakes, and we like it that way, you can say.
Was it like a mutual promotion thing for the band and the record company, or did you guys get like, was it a contract sort of thing to do that?
Yeah, it was like we had intended to do like Ultimate Revenge Part 2. Has been a project in the works for a long time with Combat. And they finally, you know, got it together to do it. You know, we were supposed to do it ever since we like signed up with Darkness. It sounds like over 2 years ago. They've been talking about it for like 2 years, putting it together. So
yeah, a lot of thing about when we play live is we get more into the crowd than, you know, sometimes we get a little carried away because actually that's who we're there for. You know, so a lot of people say, well, you guys should concentrate on a little more of this, a little more of that. It's like we like to get up in their faces and like be there because they came to see us and we came all the way around the States to see them. So
we're into more doing a show per se as opposed to just like standing there playing, which
with
is something that we really don't stand around and play. So maybe if it comes off a little bit sloppy, you know, if you're standing in the back with your arms folded going, hey, it sounds, you know, these guys sound sloppy and they're not tight or something, that's just, if you want to listen to something like that, I mean, go home and listen to the album, you know, because you're at a gig. You want to see visual, as far as we're concerned, you know, that's what we're into. So we like to do a good show, get into it with the crowd, and let the kids go nuts and stuff, and that's what we want to do.
And this is one of those record company types we're talking
about. Yeah, record moguls.
See, this is what our record company industry people look like. This is like one of our main executives, Scott Gibbons.
Executive, I was driving an equipment truck this morning. For fucking all morning.
He also hangs out with porno stars.
I do. Lois Harris.
Lois Harris is his squeeze.
What about Samantha Fox?
There's a Samantha Fox lookalike in there, kind of, sort of.
I don't know.
You guys still any tour dates with her?
No, we like to tour with her, Samantha baby. But not any live shows, mind you. We'd like to do a hotel tour with them.
Well, we'll mail this to her if we can.
We just grab her and throw her in the back and get the Instamatics going.
Yeah, we'll send you some photos. We've got photos in every city we've been in of very sick pornography, different vile acts that have been done.
Hi, babe. I wasn't in it. I'm the cameraman. I take the pictures. It's, you know, it's fun to be the cameraman, and they have them cuss and throw things at you. No, a lot of them, take my picture. Okay.
Yeah, we signed a hell of a lot of tits yesterday, man. God, yeah. It was at this record store thing. I mean, we didn't sign any today, and like yesterday, it must have been like fucking 15 chicks, man.
A plethora of tits.
Yeah, Jesus Christ. You get one like, going, man, and they all just fucking start going.
And it pulls us all away, too, because like we're a thrash band. You expect there to be all these guys to be there, you know, and all this and that. There's been a lot of females that are in stores that are willing to get in the thrash.
No, they walk up and they say, will you sign this?
It's like, okay.
I don't want to let you down or anything. You buy the album? Yeah, I got the album and the CD. Okay, fuck, I'll sign them all.
Where were you signing it?
Oh, everywhere.
Yeah.
Now I'm talking about with record stores.
Oh.
Yesterday was at Numbers in Queens. That we had the largest breast population in Queens.
Yeah,
you still playing in Bay Shore last night.
Yeah. We played Bay Shore.
It was
Bay Shore was raging.
Wild crowd, even though we're playing at 3 o'clock in the fucking morning.
There was still, everybody was there, everybody dove. I mean, there was at least about 100 stage dives during our set, and only about 7 of them were me, so. I really couldn't dive that much because everybody's diving themselves. What?
What's up?
It's been real, it's been nice.
Just shut up.
Ron Reinhart for president. And lock up your daughters. And your mom.
Ron Reinhart, give me beer.
And your sister. And your farm animals.
Man, you fucking old shit in there.
Say hi, Gene.
Hi.
No, you're supposed to say hi, Gene.
How are you?
Oral hygiene.
Oral.
He's a god.
Then hygiene. Oral hygiene.
Oldest.
Oh, I know,
oldest.
It's bad. I'm sorry.
Damn mutant bad. Hamlet bastards.
Goddamn fish bastards.
Corpse rain.
Dang it.
I want to die. I would like to die.
That's some fucking good porn. Look at that fucking shit.
All right, you want an interview to go on?
Wow.
Oh,
honey.
I'll leave.
Okay, well.
What's been the best cities? In the US, you think?
It's hard to pick one that would be better than another. Each crowd is different. I mean, they're all into the same type of scene and everything, but they all tend to act a little different. I couldn't quite pinpoint it.
We've had
some that have been favorites, but that doesn't mean that they were any better than others. Like, let's see. Buffalo
was killer, and it was like a tiny hunk of shit club. You know, it's amazing. It's like we played Lemoore's, and it was like, this gigantic thing with like 900 people there, big huge stage and everything, and everybody's standing there, you know. It's like, because you can't thrash there and stuff, you can't have any pits going.
Really?
And it's like, you know, pit would start up for a minute and then it would like stop. So you have fucking 900 people all the way to the back just standing there yelling, you know, as opposed to playing another place where kids are fucking just beach balling and diving and stuff and, you know.
Yeah. How's your hometown?
Hometown's killer.
That's what I hear. I hear LA is the wildest.
People tend to think of LA as like glam capital of the world, which in the media eye, I'm sure it is, because, I mean, that's all you see. The only bands you see coming out of there are glam bands. But when a really good thrash show comes to town, trust me, the kids come out. Our last show, what would you say we had? 1,200, 1,300 people?
It's called 2,000.
Truth, well.
That's what the official release from like Fenders and all that says.
Yeah.
Is that where you played, Fenders?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, and we completely sold out this place.
What kind of a crowd is it at Fenders?
It's a sick
hardcore crowd.
People breathe a lot, you know?
Yeah, it's like fucking 100, one of these 120 degree things, you know, it's just like you fucking just, it was like an oven when we played there, man. It was unbelievable.
Even the windows on the outside of the building completely fogged up. My brother came walking into the show. He wears glasses. His glasses fogged up the minute he came in the door.
Said you're about to see another scene like that.
Oh, that's great.
Yeah, that's we thrive on it, man. It makes us play better. The wilder the kids get, man, it's just like Lemours, man, just kind of threw me off. I would have known that the kids weren't going to be moving. It was just like playing out there and not seeing these guys moving around. It's just like, fuck, what's going on? You know? So we're just used to it. Every other gig, every fucking gig, it's just kids just go nuts, you know. And we just, you know, when we played at this place in Boston, they had this huge, all these big pillars and stuff. Like about 20 feet off from the stage, kids are just running full board. They just flip and bounce off the pole. It was unbelievable.
So it was barricaded from the stage. And these kids that would be crowded up to the front were getting crushed so bad by the people in the back. I mean, we're seeing bloody noses of kids. Like when people would dive off and land on their heads, their heads would smash against the barrier.
That
was a lot of carnage.
Oh,
yeah. I mean,
and they loved it. They look up at you with a bloody face and just go, yeah, and get all crazy and jump again. It's like, kids are nuts, man.
It's like, we don't like want to see anybody get hurt, I mean, you know, but
I guess
it's just accidents,
like,
you know. I mean, it's not like there wasn't really too many fights or nothing. The only place we really seen these fights were like when in Boston there was like about 10 skins that were like kind of fucking things up for the rest of the guys, you know, but there wasn't really any fights or anything.
There's not a problem. I hear LA's got a problem with them.
Yeah, games. There'll be like, I don't know, I think when we played there, someone said there was like 3 fights when we played. It's not really as bad as it almost used to be. I think it's kind of mellowed off, the fight thing in LA, because it used to be really bad. There'd be like a bunch of like the suicidal tendency kind of gang thing would be going on, and they'd kind of like rat pack on people and stuff and just kind of fuck it up for it. It's a drag when you got, you know, like some young kids that want to go to a gig, you know, young metal kids and shit, and then they're, you know, all these fucking get fucked around with by like 6 guys that are like fucking in their middle 20s and shit, you know. It's just not fair.
Yeah, that's what I heard.
It's also kind of amazing out there. I mean, yeah, I don't know if I should be saying this for an interview or something, but like you get a lot of, no, I'm not putting down any certain type of people that are into their own little clique and music or whatever, but you get certain types that come in, for example, say suicidals or skinheads that come in, and they start like beating up on the younger, small kids with long hair and stuff. And these younger kids outnumber them by about 20-1. If they would pull together, they could like throw these guys right out. They would have no problems with them. I just don't understand.
What are the suicidal gangs like?
It's just
in LA, there's
they're not really skinheads.
There's an area like Venice Beach, Santa Monica.
Yeah.
And they all tend to follow around the suicidals. You know, the suicidals are a great band. We're good friends with the whole band. You know.
There's all kinds, you know, they're like, you know, Mexican guys and white guys and just everything. There's all kinds of different, like, subdivision kind of things. Like, you know, they all deny that it's a big gang or whatever. Maybe it isn't, you know, but, I mean, you see all these fucking guys wearing hats. I mean, they look just like the guys in the fucking band, you know. So you tell me what they're doing, you know, and all the guys in the band deny it, and it's not even worth talking about, really. It seems to have mellowed out, I think, now, lately. Because, I mean, the last gig that we played was, like, gigantic at Fender's, like the biggest one they've seen there in you know, the past 8 months or something, I would say, pretty damn safely. Mm-hmm. And there wasn't really that much shit going on. So maybe it's just going away.
You
don't
want to correct something?
Grammatical error, maybe?
Not really. The subject of gangs, you know, there's violence wherever you go. And Los Angeles is definitely no exception in terms of people who are there to pay their money to beat up on somebody. You know, they're no different than like a lot of other negative scenes. And with Los Angeles, there's such an amalgamation of styles and people living there that you're gonna find, you know, the bad seed ratio is probably a little smaller than say Philadelphia. You know, I hear Philadelphia has a raging scene, and we've, you know,
see, there's nothing like that here. There's no gangs.
See, that's cool.
Yeah, that's
I mean, it should be. Everybody should just get along together. I mean, if you're all into the same music, why not go out and enjoy it together?
I mean, I hear it's sort of in New York, but it's not really organized. And I hear it's in Chicago.
It's not really, I don't really think it's so much gangs as opposed to just like a bunch of skinheads will come.
Yeah.
A bunch of punks, basically. You know, like punk types or something.
Yeah,
you know?
We don't want to label them as skinheads or suicidals.
You know,
it's just like bad seeds in the crowd.
Yeah, I don't know what these guys were doing in Boston, you know. I mean, they seemed like they were all fucking like into it or something. But I mean, to just like fucking tweak on guys that are so much smaller, you know, you get these kids up in front that are trying to enjoy the thing and have a good time, they pay their money, and then, you know, some guy's like flying up from the back and stomps on the guy's head.
Stomping on their head, you know, it's just like, what the hell? Back off, you know?
You know, it's like, what the hell are you doing that for? You know, we had a merchandiser, a guy who does our merchandise, man, is like fucking huge, and he just went out there and just fucking
straightened them out.
Yeah, went out and fucking made a slam hit. You know? And once you see this guy, you'll know.
I saw him. He was selling new t-shirts, right?
Yeah, he doesn't like that shit, you know.
Hmm? No, he's someone's brother. Well, I don't know. I guess this interview's been pretty long, so are there any closing words or anything?
We'll just hope we endure the tour.
Thank everybody who supported us so far because it's been great. We were kind of worried that, you know, with such a long release time between our 2 hours, we might have lost a little ground. But now we're out on the road, we're seeing, man, these kids have made it up to us, like, you know, they've made us feel like we haven't lost anything. It's just like, thanks a lot, man. Yeah. You guys, everything we've got.
Goddamn corpse invisible old man.
I gotta check and see if Sean's doing my strings.
Yeah, all the tour's been going really good, and I'm sure it's gonna keep on going good. You know,
yeah,
so
we'll be out till when?
Yeah, I got, you know, 35, probably, you know, another 35 shows or something across the U.S., and then probably take some time off and then go down to Europe or something. So here, some more, you know, medium-sized venue kind of tour things, and just keep going.
There's also talk of a second part of this tour. Right now on the Ultimate Revenge Part 2, and that's with Death. After Death finishes off with us, I think on May 15th at the Cat Club in New York, and then we're going back out on our own.
Which is one? The
Live Scars tour.
The Live Scars?
Live Scars.
You like doing over 21? You like doing bar shows?
No, all ages by far. We love to drink ourselves, but I mean,
it snubs out too much of the audience.
I do not drink myself.
In New York, it isn't like that, though. Anyone can go into a bar, right?
Is this a 21 and over place here?
No way.
See, the way the bars are here, right? If there's a bar, unless you have a club where there's a bar upstairs and you have to be carded to go.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. It's like here, no one can get in, or, you know, I mean, if they, you know.
So, there's no alcohol tonight.
Like, this is the only all-ages day they have here, so.
And this, there's no alcohol.
Yeah, you can't sell alcohol.
Hey, what's going on right there? Is that on that side or this side?
Oh, it's fucking
a couple nice girls right there.
It's Steve.
Yeah, get them on camera.
Rules. Oh, yeah.
Wait, where's our sign? Oh, look, it's the chick from the Ultimate Revenge. Where's our sign?
I left it.
Yeah, I remember her.
She showed her breasts.
Yeah, we've got like 20 minutes of this bimbo throwing her tits.
Tits.
You ugly piece of shit.
God, let's get some tits.
Damn, hip broke.
Yeah, let's get some tits.
Come on, tits.
Let's get some tits. Come on.
Where's Carol?
Okay, get her in. Bring her in.
I don't want to see him, but these guys.
Yeah, come on. We got look, Grope. See, here we have Rody Grope.
Here we go.
Rody molestation.
Come on, Grope. Camera. Go. Here, get the camera quick.
Do it! Video!
Come on, tits.
Wait, open them.
Bring her in.
Pieces of shit.
Bring her in, it's better.
Here, okay. Video tit shot. Come on, tit shot. Come on.
Tits will be shown if you hold this.
It's video. For MTV,
come on.
Man.
It's
MTV.
Come on.
Yeah, it's be the only time MTV ever shows tits on stage. Come on, no one's free. Come on.
We'll block you.
Come on.
Don't be a fucking tease.
Nah, you're not funny, too, guys.
But then you go. Well, you can come in here and show them if you.
Yeah.
Come in here and show them. We already seen you. You've shaved your left tip about a billion times!
In slow motion, in freeze frame, closed caption, analyze
your left tip extensively
here.
Already.
Let's see the right one to see if it matches the left one.
We've seen your tip a lot!
Go there, everybody go in there and get your food.
Yeah, come on, go.
Food.
And then we can get the hell out of here.
So let's go eat.
Hey, did you lose your battery?
My screen's down.
Yes, sir.
Hey, we were there at that shop. I have that.
I found it already.
Okay.
Goddamn.
I just walked by without you even knowing. I snaked it off you.
I don't like this. I don't like
people
taking my
way. Dude,
I'm
sorry.
Donna, let's go. We're going to go take a shower together.
Yeah,
all right, Mom.
One of us is fucking around.
I'm just fucking around.
That's cool.
Who wants this?
So we don't have any tit on this John, camera or no?
What? What's your name?
Camera yeah, yeah. Come on, what the hell?
Don't be a T.
What's the cameraman's name?
I don't know.
Sal.
Sal.
Come on.
Thanks, Sal.
Come back to the hotel on, with us. And, because we've seen the left one's on the video. Hurry, come on. We gotta go take showers. We'll be back.
Donna, come on.
Come on. Just get really close.
Donna. Show your tits.
Just show your tit. One. Singular.
Right.
Just the right one. Come on.
It's not like you're gonna scare people away.
Donna, if you don't do it on your own,
it's gonna happen.
You'll never get in free. If you're planning on getting in free, you won't get in free.
That's right, no Bex.
Hey,
you got great boobs too. Oh, jeez, I ain't begging for nothing.
Yeah, forget about it.
No, hey.
No.
Sean's a fucking. Oh, Jesus Christ. The cop's over there.
Yeah,
the
cop's over
there. Yes, I am. I'll be the first to admit it.
Sean.
Hey.
Yes, Sean. I got both.
Do me a real big favor and go get everybody that's going to take showers.
Are we taking the rider?
No. It's staying here.
Okay, almost, come on. Come on.
Sean.
Can you just give me one cup?
Yeah, shall we?
Yeah, what about her buddy?
You can even stand behind the door.
Yeah, it's a freeze. Come on, that's why. It's cold outside. Get out of here.
Yeah, it's cold outside. Let your dick get hard.
Come on in here.
Sean.
We've got ice.
Don't drag me.
Yeah, we'll rub ice on you, Donna.
And then we'll lick it off and make it all warm.
Nice and toasty.
Don't fight. Or you're just going to make the cop take us to jail for rape.
No, I'll totally run all night.
Or he'll help.
She's determined. Go.
Come on.
Go.
Ah, we see. Now I always saw some cleavage. Well, that was some cleavage. Come on, some nipple.
We'll stand like this and nobody.
Just come in. It's a lot easier.
I like that. Wait.
Tie up.
One, two, three. Go.
It's the right one.
Sean, duck your head, Sean.
One. I'm kind of five. Do it.
Then come over closer.
Two, three, four, five.
Your sister.
How do you turn it on?
You see a little green light in there? Look in there. You see a little green light?
Oh, yeah.
I mean, it's Ronnie.
It's not Ronnie.
It is Ronnie.
It says light.
Right. The light means it's not getting enough light on me.
School of
so you keep turning it, you're like, yeah, it's going to feel shaky. It's not going to look good.
Can I go outside and film people?
No.
No.
This is crazy shit.
What's that? Here. How do you zoom in?
There's
a little bomb right here.
That's.
Okay, look, for your finger. That's forward.
Alright, we went forward.
Back.
Where?
Okay. That's
do
forward.
You know what you're doing?
This is?
That's backwards.
And that's forward.
Alright, we got the camera.
Okay.
Wait!
Now, if you want to get. They made a deal. What? They're going to bare their tits. They're going to take out the picture.
Okay.
Now, they're going to take
Scott
it out.
Scott Gibbons is going to be here and shit like that.
Okay, hit
all the drums. They have an in house security guy doing it.
Yeah, hit the horn. Fuck with the guys.
So mad, we gotta get this shit.
Everybody sit. We gotta close the doors.
We're about to leave. You guys might not want to leave.
We're
going to our hotel.
Done? What? Yeah.